Hello everyone, my name is Simon Vigier, and today I will talk about hardware accelerated dynamic binary translation for RISC-V. So this work has been done in Université de Rennes 1 in France with Steven Dorian and Erwin Roux. So embedded systems are everywhere in our life. It goes from smartphones, smartwatch, all the way to self-driving cars and drones. These systems are characterized by very tight constraints in terms of power consumption, production cost, and performances. So today I will mainly focus on the aspect of power consumption and performance, and how we can trade off between the two. Another need that is emerging in today's embedded system is the need for adaptability. It means that on the same system, you will want to run different kinds of applications, some that will require high performances and others that will prefer to be executed in low power mode. So to answer that need, we are building complex heterogeneous systems with different kinds of CPUs. The best example of that is the Big-LITTLE architecture from ARM, where they have two different types of cores. So one out-of-order superscalar processor, which is here to deliver high performances, and the in-order core, which is here to the low power execution. So here is a representation from ARM of the different trade-offs you can have between power and performance. So you have two curves. The blue one corresponds to the trade-off you can have by changing the frequency of the out-of-order, and the red one is what you can have by changing the frequency of the in-order core. So what you can see on this picture is that there is a gap between the in-order and the out-of-order cores, and this is the cost of the out-of-order. So what we would like is to offer more trade-off, better trade-off, by using a different kind of architecture, which has a VLIW. So I will do a quick comparison between out-of-order processor and VLIW. The idea of out-of-order processor is to read a stream of instruction, to dynamically decode and rename the registers, and then to use a reorder buffer to try to reorganize them in order to exploit instruction level parallelism. So because of all these complex mechanisms, the out-of-order processor is very efficient and has a performance portability. It means that the same core will be efficient on many different kinds of binaries. And the main counterpart is that all these hardware mechanisms and this dynamic analysis cost a lot of energy, so the power efficiency is much lower. On the other hand, you have VLIW processors, which are based on static scheduling. It means that the VLIW will now read bundles of instructions, knowing that each instruction inside a bundle can be executed in parallel. So the VLIW will just read these bundles and execute the instruction without performing any analysis. It's the compiler that will create these bundles statically. So because of this organization, there is no portability at all. It means that if you compile your application for a given VLIW, you won't be able to execute it on another VLIW or on another architecture. The good part is that you now have a very good energy efficiency because the VLIW is only doing the execution part and there is no analysis to perform. So what we would like to do is to have the best of both worlds. It means that we would like to have the performance and the performance portability of an out-of-order processor while having the energy consumption of the VLIW. So to do that, we propose to use a dynamic binary translation. So the idea is simple. You will compile statically your binaries into your application into RISC-V, let's say. And then when you start the execution, you will spend some time to translate them into VLIW binaries and to execute these VLIWs binaries. So with that, you have the portability because you will do the last step, the translation dynamically. And you also have the energy efficiency of the VLIW. So this approach has already been done by other industries. So we can cite Transmeta in the year 2000, which idea was to execute x86 binaries on the VLIW, and NVIDIA Denver architecture, which is more recent, around 2011, which idea is to execute ARM binaries on VLAW. So what we can remember from those two previous approaches is that the translation of array is critical. So I have the example of the CUSE array architecture, on which even if the performances were really good on long term, when you start the execution, the user experience is polluted by the translation of array. And another important information is that we have no information because these two platforms are totally closed and we don't really know what they do inside. So what we've done is we developed an open source dynamic binary translation framework. And to reduce the cost of the translation, we developed several hardware accelerators which are here to accelerate the critical part of the DBT and to make the translation cheaper, both in terms of time and energy. And all this work is open source and can be downloaded on GitHub. I will give the link at the end. So the rest of the presentation is organized as follows. I'll try to make you understand how the DBT platform works, what is the cost of the different steps, and the reason why we develop the hardware accelerators. And I will present in detail the different optimization level in DBT. Then I will try to give you some experimental results, and I will conclude. So let's start. Let's say that you have a given RISC-V binary file. You want to execute it on your VLAW. So obviously, you cannot just execute it because you do not have binary compatibility. So what you will do is you will translate these binaries into VLAW binaries, but you do not want to spend some time doing this first translation. If you are running some code that will be executed only once, you do not want to execute very good quality code. You just want a nice translation. So the first optimization level is just doing this direct translation from source binaries into VLAW binaries, and do not try to exploit instruction level parallelism. When you find the hotspot, so part of the code that will be executed many times, you decide to trigger the optimization level 1, which idea is to exploit fully the VLAW, so to execute instruction in parallel. So to do that, you will read the VLAW binaries you generated. From that, you will build an intermediate representation, which is an higher level representation of the part of code you want to optimize. And you will use this intermediate representation to perform instruction scheduling and generate VLAW binaries, which are better quality, so which now exploit instruction level parallelism. So you may ask how we trigger this optimization level 1. So during the optimization level 0, we also inserted some profiling instructions, which are here to count how many times, for example, a block is executed. And if we reach a certain threshold, then we trigger the next optimization level. So as we do not exploit instruction level parallelism in the first optimization level, adding some instruction in the blank instruction was very simple. So to give an idea of the cost of these different steps, we developed a software version of this DBT framework. So this version is just for prototyping and it's not fully optimized, but it's just to give you an idea. So all the DBT process is implemented on software, and we run the software on a VLAW. And we summarize the result by counting how many cycles we need to translate to perform a step on a single source instruction. So for example, for the first direct translation, we needed around 150 cycles per instruction. So it's very huge. I think we could reduce that by doing some optimization, but still, if you will execute the code only once, you will spend many cycles to do this translation. And the optimization level 1, building the intermediate representation and performing the instruction scheduling needs 400 cycles per instruction and 500 cycles per instruction. So if you want to exploit fully the VLAW capabilities, you will need to spend around 1,000 cycles per instruction you want to translate. So you have to make sure that the code you are optimizing will be executed very often to trigger this optimization. So what we've done is we developed 3 different hardware accelerators which are used in these 3 critical steps. So One which is here to do the first night translation very efficiently so that we can start the execution as soon as possible. And two others that are here to build the intermediate representation and to perform the instruction scheduling. So a quick word about the first pass translation. So this accelerator is very simple. It's implemented as a simple finite state machine. And it will translate each source instruction into one or two VLIW instructions. And it's capable of producing one VLIW instruction per cycle. So you will need around one cycle to translate one source instruction. So I have to say that this first pass translation is very simple here because we are using two instruction sets that are very similar. So from one pass there is a RISC-V and the other part is the one from the VLIW. And the semantic is very similar, so there is no much work to do. But if we plan to go on other architecture, let's say ARM, the idea will be the same. Maybe the accelerator will be more complex, but I think that the throughput will be more or less the same. The optimization level one, so as I said, the idea is to build an higher level representation of the code you want to optimize, and then to perform instruction scheduling. So this step is critical if you want to fully exploit the VLIW. So in our first experiment, we determined that even if the cost of the higher builder and higher scheduler was the same in software, doing the instruction scheduling is much more difficult to accelerate. So our idea was to define the intermediate representation in order to make the scheduling as simple as possible. So here is an idea of the representation we used. So we chose to encode the complete data flow graph of the block we are optimizing inside the intermediate representation. It means that for all instructions, you will have direct access to the number of dependencies inside the block and to the name of all successors inside the block. So here, for example, if you look at this store here, so it's encoded here, so you can see that there is zero dependencies because the store can be executed at the start of the block. And you see that you have one successor, which is instruction one. So during instruction scheduling, you know that you can schedule the store instruction as soon as possible. And you know that once you schedule it, you can make the instruction one step closer to being ready to be executed. So this intermediate representation is quite heavy. It's encoded on 128 bits per instruction, but it allows to make the scheduling step cheaper. So a quick word about how these different accelerators are implemented. So the IR Builder is implemented as a very simple one-pass dependency analysis. So we just go through all the instructions, keep track of the last register read and build the dependency graph with that. And then the IR scheduler is another implementation of the least scheduling algorithm. And obviously, developing these two accelerators in VHDL was out of reach, so we used high-level synthesis for that. So not Gisel, but real high-level synthesis. And we perform optimization on the code like loops unrolling and pipelining, memory partitioning, memory access factorization, and explicit programming. So if you want to have more information about that, I invite you to see the related paper. So now I'll try to give a quick word about the experimental study. So the first thing we wanted to demonstrate is the gain from the hardware accelerators. So here I compare the two implementations I have, so the one on software when all the translation is done on the VLIW, and another one which uses the three accelerators I just described. So on the one that uses the accelerator, I can say also that there is a dedicated DBT processor which is here to manage the DBT process and call the different accelerators. So all these experiments were done on fully functional platform on FPGA. So this first slide gives the result for the optimization level zero, so the first naive translation. So the left part for you is the number of cycles you need to translate one source instruction using the accelerator. So you can see, as I said, that you need around one cycle to translate one instruction. And the white part is the comparison, the speed up compared with the software implementation. So here we are around 100 and 150 times faster. So as I said, the software implementation is not totally optimized, so I think it could be reduced a bit, but it's still a huge speed up. And it's mainly because it's instruction decoding and re-encoding in a different instruction set. Then for the optimization level one, so same results. On the left part, you have the number of cycles you need to perform each step using the accelerators. So here, to build the IR, it's very fast, so you only need 13 to 15 cycles per instruction to build the 128-bit representation. But performing the scheduling is a bit more complex. The accelerator will need around 100 cycles per instruction to generate the scheduling. So here, if we look at speedup compared with software implementation, for building the IR, we are around 30 times faster. Once again, it's because much of the work is decoding the instruction and keeping track of the last written instruction. But performing the instruction scheduling is only accelerated by a factor of 5, so it's still the main bottleneck. So all the work we've done at designing the intermittent representation lead to only, if I can say, to a speedup of 5, but it's still the main bottleneck of this process. A little word of the overhead in terms of area. So I shown earlier some speed up the results, but all this has a cost. So we added 3 different accelerators and a dedicated processor to manage the DBT process. And we made an experiment to measure how much it represents in terms of silicon. And we found that the 3 accelerators and the DBT processor has the same cost as the BLAW for issues. So it's not negligible, but we think that if we share this overhead with different BLAWs, so we can use one DBT platform for different BLAWs, then we can reduce the overhead. And finally, the last slide and the most recent result is the comparison between the out-of-order architecture and the DBT process on the VLAW. So what I wanted to show here is how the DBT process running on VLAW can compare with an out-of-order execution. So I measured the power consumption of the Boom implementation of the Boom core, and I measured the one of my VLAW. I found that there was a that my implementation consumed 5 times less power. So that's what I said before about the energy efficiency. And when I compare the performances, I found that using the DBT, I can reach around 20 to 40% of the performances of the out-of-order core. So it's still very low, but I have to say that we are still under development. It's work in progress, so we hope to go further. So for example, for the 2 first benchmarks, I noticed that they always stay at optimization level 0. It means that the profiling code is not able to detect the hotspot and to trigger the optimization level 1. So that's just simple problems that could be easily solved. So I hope in future version to reach 50 or 60% of the performances of the out of order architecture. So to conclude this presentation, I presented here Hybrid DBT Framework, which is another accelerated DBT framework for RISC-V. It's able to execute RISC-V binaries on VLAW transparently. And I have a tested FPGA prototype. Everything is available on GitHub at this address. And I'd like also to spend 1 minute to present another project we have in my university, which is called SINTI. So it's a synthesizable SIMT CPU. So in GPUs, the idea of single instruction, multiple thread execution is to assemble the vector across different threads of the same process. So it's a vector processing based on scalar instruction set architecture. So SINTI, which we developed in Université de Rana, is a proof of concept of a single instruction multiple thread architecture on general purpose binaries. So it means that it will be able to execute unmodified RISC-V binaries using single instruction multiple thread. It's written in synthesizable VHDL. You can parameterize the warp size and the warp count, and you can, it's a 10-stage in-order pipeline. So if you want to have more information about this project and if you want to see the picture displayed correctly, I invite you to go on the website. So thank you, if you have any question.
Hi, I have a question. What is the main difference between your MEST and the traditional dynamic schedule MEST such as and the scoreboard?
Yeah. Okay, so in this version, the accelerator implements a least scheduling algorithm, which is a bit different from the scoreboard scheduling. Normally, list scheduling provides a bit better result schedules, but we are we do not measure that. We will plan to implement a scoreboard scheduler. The main difference, if your question was about the dynamic scheduling performed in the out of order, is that once you've done the schedule once in the IR, you can reuse it at each iteration, for example. So you will perform the schedule only once. You do not have to do it, for example, at each iteration of a loop.
So you initially do optimization zero. The code is executing, you're profiling. At some point, you decide to take a fragment of the code, compile it to optimization one. Is that done in parallel? Particularly
yes.
With the accelerator?
I have a second core which is here to manage the DBT, so it will regularly watch at the profiling results and decide to optimize the block. And once the optimization is done, the VLIW is stopped and the new version is downloaded inside the cache.
When you presented your power results and you said that the power of the call is 5 times lower than the out-of-order machine, was that scaled for the fact that the performance was lower?
That's really interesting.
Was that scaled for the fact that the performance was lower? So did you integrate across the whole operation? Or?
I don't get it. There is a...
Okay, so your execution time was longer.
Yeah.
And the power was lower.
It's dynamic power. It's not the energy cost.
Okay, so if you're running at 20% of the speed,
yeah,
and you're 5 times lower power, you've said nothing. Right?
Actually, for the moment, I think that my implementation is not competitive with out of order. DVFS will lead to better trade-offs. But I think that with more better optimization, I just have to solve a few problems and maybe we'll reach the 80% performances of an out of order, and then the 5 times will be more interesting.
I didn't quite follow the good question and answer. So are you measuring power for a fixed task or a unit of time?
Unit of time.
Okay.